One of the big looming questions, will the president testify under oath about his firing of FBI Director James Comey? When he was asked about it today, the president said he would absolutely be willing to do it.
So he said those things under oath. Would you be willing to speak under oath to give your version of those events?
100%. And I didn't say under oath. I hardly know the man. I'm not going to say, I want you to pledge allegiance. Who would do that? Who would ask a man to pledge allegiance under oath? I mean, think of it. I hardly know the man. It doesn't make sense. No, I didn't say that, and I didn't say the other.
So if Robert Mueller wanted to speak with you about that,
I would be glad to tell him exactly what I just told you.
So if it actually happens, President Trump would not be the first president to testify under oath. A number of presidents have done it. But President Bill Clinton was the first sitting president who testified under oath as part of an investigation about his own behavior. Presidential historian Douglas Brinkley joins us now, along with Jeffrey Lord, and Carl Bernstein is back as well. You know, Doug, it is very rare that presidents testify under oath. It has happened, and as we said, you know, President Clinton was the first one to do it, having to deal with a criminal investigation of his own conduct.
Well, that's right. I mean, Bill Clinton in U.S. presidential history was the Hank Aaron of sworn testimony from June of 1994 to August of 1998. All Bill Clinton did was give sworn testimony over and over again, and Hillary Clinton for that matter. It ended up not particularly well for Bill Clinton, and the fact he had to do 5.5 hours with Ken Starr on August 17, 1998, and then had to go on public to the public airwaves television and say, look, I'm guilty. But I think the key here is to look at what happened with Ronald Reagan doing it during the Iran-Contra. For Lawrence Walsh in 1998, Reagan agreed to answer questions in writing. And so you might be, with Donald Trump's a tricky character, he might say 100% sworn testimony, but I'll answer your questions in writing. You might see his lawyers push Trump to deal with it that way, because putting him in front of a Mueller for 5.5 hours is a disaster for Donald Trump.
You know, Jeffrey Lord, Doug said the buzzwords, which make you perk up, which is Ronald Reagan.
What was that, John?
Exactly. He said Ronald Reagan, so I have to ask you the next question by law here. do you think that the president should testify under oath, unless, for argument's sake, say out loud in front of Bob Mueller?
I'll leave it to the lawyers, but I like the Reagan solution. Do it in writing. John, this is about a war between Washington and the Washington establishment and a lot of the American people. And that really is what's going on here. And Washington, I mean, I worked there for a long time. I love the place. But boy, it is tribal warfare. These scenes that you would see of people lining up in bars at 9 o'clock in the morning in Washington, D.C. to watch the Comey hearings, I assure you, right here in the middle of Pennsylvania, that was not happening, to the best of my knowledge.
Well, 19 million people watched the hearings on television yesterday, which is as many as watched the NBA Game 3. And I don't think you would say that Game 3 of the NBA Finals is somehow tribal warfare in the United States. I think it's a separate issue, Jeffrey, but to the issue of whether or not the president should testify. Carl Bernstein, you earlier said it would be a remarkable thing if the president answered questions under oath. Carl, what did you mean?
Well, first of all, once he got in there, if it was open-ended, it could be devastating and probably would be, because it would be a license for a prosecutor to go into all of Trump's history in terms of his finances, Russians, Russian money, all kinds of Pandora's box that Trump has spent years trying to keep people from opening. It's unthinkable to me that he would permit that, but there is a problem, I think, that he has, and I'll leave it to the lawyers to discuss, and that is activities that took place before he was president of the United States, because a lot of what we're talking about here occurred before he was president of the United States, including the possibility of criminal activity then. I'm not suggesting he engaged in criminal activity, but it certainly is something that prosecutors would want to look at. So there's a real Pandora's box, to repeat that phrase, because it's so apt here. And the other instance we have of a president before a grand jury, actually, is Nixon. After he was president of the United States, he did 11 hours before a grand jury, and the testimony wasn't released until a few years ago, and it was a horrible picture of President Nixon, angry, vindictive, and one that he did not want to see released. He thought that testimony would never be released.
You know, Douglas Brinkley, one of the things that we've seen from the Trump White House is they've actually looked at the Clinton White House, how it behaved when it was under siege during impeachment. And in some ways, it's taken some lessons from that. Well, if they look at the issue of Bill Clinton having to testify during that time, what lessons should the Trump White House take from that?
Well, if you're Donald Trump, you realize Bill Clinton survived all of this. He was reelected, and then by the time he left office in 2001, was wildly popular. Many people thought Al Gore lost the 2000 election because Bill Clinton wasn't on his side, that he treated him like a pariah figure. The other thing that Bill Clinton did was he never gave up. He just kept scrapping and fighting and fighting, giving States of the Union addresses, defending his honor, defending himself. Eventually, he had to admit guilt. But, you know, you want to be careful not to put sloppy sound bites out there. I think that's going to be Donald Trump's big problem, that, you know, Bill Clinton now lives in history for, you know, it depends on what the definition of is. You don't want to see Donald Trump going down, you know, it depends on what the definition of, you know, certain words are and splitting hairs, because that kind of looks like guilt when you do that.
And Jeffrey Lord, you know, Donald Trump has testified before. He appeared before a lawyer just in January in a civil disposition. There was a 2007 case, which the Washington Post reported on extensively, in which his honesty was called into question. They said he lied a full 30 times there. Is the president's past, you know, dalliance with honesty, could that be an issue if he appears before Bob Mueller?
Well, if that's an issue, then Bob Mueller's an issue. I mean, one of the things we've learned from the Comey testimony is that he did various actions to tilt things to Bob Mueller, who was one of his best buddies. I mean, this already throws into credibility Mueller's testimony, who up until now has gotten rave reviews. But when
so you're questioning whether or not Robert Mueller, you know, is a respectable special counsel now?
No, what I'm saying is it's very clear that James Comey admitted in his testimony that he took various actions in leaking so that he could get his friend Bob Mueller to you know, act. Now, right there, that says that there's a problem here.
Well,
he did
admit that he did provide that memo to his friend because he wanted to see a special counsel appointed. He didn't use the words Bob Mueller.
Well, that's right.
The testimony.
In other words, he's manipulating things. I mean, this is the. Let's get beyond James Comey. I mean, this is
right,
how
but
Washington.
One of the ways the pundits work occasionally is by taking leaps of logic here. And Bob Mueller, his name was not even mentioned. There was no special counsel appointed. And then after the idea, you know, and Bob Mueller's name wasn't even circulating. And you're saying that James Comey wanted to see Bob Mueller appointed as special counsel. James Comey's been criticized by Rod Rosenstein, the guy who appointed it.
Simply observing the fact that by his own definition, he's great friends with Bob Mueller. I'm simply observing that. That is a fact.
Let's talk about what really happened here. And it was one of the most fascinating moments of Comey's testimony. He acknowledged, and it was a spectacular moment, that he more or less engineered the appointment of a special prosecutor. That was his objective,
yes.
Not necessarily Robert Mueller. And why was that his objective? Because it is obvious from his testimony, he thought there was a cover-up going on, a cover-up in which the President of the United States might well and probably was involved. Let me finish, please. From his point of view. And also the role of Jeff Sessions. He went to the Attorney General and told him about his session. Keep me away from the president, et cetera. And when that failed, yes, he indeed tried to engineer getting a special prosecutor, and he has succeeded. And why has he succeeded? Because there is an underlying case of the most important thing that perhaps we have faced in a nation, in a kind of attack we've never faced before, and that is what the Russians did to our electoral process. And we're trying to find out what happened, a legitimate inquiry, and we have a president of the United States who was obstructed, demeaned, undermined, and tried to make that investigation go away since he's been in office, and it speaks volumes. I'm not saying he's obstructed justice. We'll find that out.
All right, guys.
But that's where we are.
Thank you, everyone.